Good morning. Welcome to First United Methodist Church for our 9 o'clock worship. It is a joy to have you here today. You have come on a special day for a lot of different reasons. For one thing, it's just a gorgeous day outside. Isn't it amazing? So grateful to God for a beautiful fall day. So grateful to God for our band. I think this is our biggest band ever. Have we ever had this big before? Ten people. It's like our own Arcade Fire. This is amazing. So so grateful to God for them. Pastor Jeannie's preaching, so that's really cool. She's passionate about preaching about our ministry with senior adults, and she's really excited that the Royals are in the World Series. And so there's all sorts of, as some of you are too, all sorts of excitement and joy going on this morning. Most of all, we're grateful to God that you're here. Your presence makes this hour special. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ here. Makes this hour special. We're grateful that you're a part of it. My name is Daniel Hilty. I'm one of the pastors here, and it is such a privilege to share in these moments with you. If you are visiting, you're a blessing, and we give thanks to God for you. I invite us to take a moment now to please stand, pass the peace of Christ to those around us, especially if there is a new face somewhere nearby us. may be seated. Will you please pray with me? Oh God, we give you thanks that you hold on to us forever. In all of the highs of life and all of the lows of life, in our good days and our bad days, as the years roll by, you remain faithful and you remain good. And we give you our thanks. We thank you for making us a part of your family and being that common bond that binds us all together. Oh God, this morning we entrust to your steadfast and faithful love and care all of those who are in need of a special sign of your presence today. We pray for wisdom, O Lord, for those who lead us. We pray for healing, O Lord, for those who are sick. We pray for comfort, O Lord, for those who grieve today, who are sad today. We pray for your providence and your care and your abundance for those who are in need. We pray for friendship for those who feel lonely. We pray for peace for those who live in the midst of violence and war and fear. And God, we pray that you would help us to offer not only our prayers this morning, in these moments together, help us to offer ourselves as well. Shape us, O God, and strengthen us, and turn us into instruments for you. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is your word of faithfulness and grace, and who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. It is now time for children's worship. Children, I want to call your attention to Miss Sherry, our family minister, who's standing right there by the door to our lobby. She's waving at you. You can go ahead and work on your way over there, and she will lead you to children's worship. Parents, grandparents, anybody else who brought a child that you currently see leaving the room, if you haven't signed them out yet, please do that. We'd appreciate it very much. We pray for God's blessings on our children during their children's worship. We pray for God's blessing as we continue this worship service as well. We continue our moments of worship with our scripture reading today. Our scripture comes from the book of 1 Kings, the second chapter. In this scripture reading, we encounter King David, the most famous king of all of Israel's history. King David comes to the end of his life, and in the last moments of his life, he gives a blessing on his son Solomon, who will become the next king of Israel. So from 1 Kings chapter 2, when David's time to die drew near, he charged his son Solomon, saying, I am about to go the way of all the earth. Be strong, be courageous, and keep the charge of the Lord your God, walking in his ways and keeping his statutes, his commandments, his ordinances, and his testimonies, as it is written in the law of Moses, so that you may prosper in all that you do and wherever you turn.
Then the Lord will establish his word that he spoke concerning me. If your heirs take heed to their way to walk before me in faithfulness with all their heart and with all their soul, there shall not fail you a successor on the throne of Israel. Then David slept with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David. The time that David reigned over Israel was 40 years. He reigned 7 years in Hebron and 33 years in Jerusalem. So Solomon sat on the throne of his father David, and his kingdom was firmly established. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. I'm Pastor Jeannie Martin Dudenhofer. I'm one of the three pastors here, and I'm very, very grateful for this opportunity to share with you in worship. If you are a guest here with us today, we are especially grateful that you've come to worship. If you are part of our television audience or view us over the internet, we are grateful you're worshiping with us too. All of us come together to be one community waiting for God. Let's pray together. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, O our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So we've been looking at the circle of life and how God has a purpose for whatever stage of life in which we find ourselves. You heard about missions and how God can use us in making a difference. Here's my bracelet from Thorpe Gordon, my Fuse Day souvenir from yesterday. You've heard about our students, teenagers, and not discouraging them from changing the world in Jesus' name. Daniel talked to us about junior adults. Who knew junior adults? To use Richard Rohr's term. Last week, we heard about God's desire for children to come to the Savior and to bless the world through their spiritual gifts and insights. Up on the third floor, where we've been doing some refurbishing, there's a wall that talks about our children in ministry. Think about that. Today, we're going to talk about growing older. Not growing older. Definitely growing older. To use Stephen King's words from The Shawshank Redemption, if you're not busy living, you're busy dying. Either we continue to grow throughout our lifespan, or we begin dying. So what's it going to be? We have more scripture stories about King David than about anyone else in all of scripture. As far as narrative goes, we know even more about his story than about Jesus's. Some things we might wish to know. We have details about David that are about his childhood, relationships, day-to-day life. And Jesus's own life and identity is rooted in his being a descendant of David. We see parts of David's story in 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 Kings, 1 Chronicles, and of course, in his own words in the Psalms, such as what I just prayed at the beginning of this sermon. We see David, without apparent panic, speaking to Solomon about his succession to the throne and how that will take place. David is concerned at the very end with Solomon's faithfulness to God and the law. He reminds him what Solomon already knows. If Israel will keep its focus on God, there will always be a successor on the throne in Israel. Unfortunately, this was not to be. We get only into the next generation after Solomon to find his son an evil ruler. Senior adults are sometimes charged with reminding their families and others who look to them for leadership, what is important. God provides good sense sometimes in the voices of our elders. Think about it. Our senior adults are the only ones who've been all the rest of the ages. And this generation of seniors is the first one to live into their 80s and 90s and even beyond in large numbers. So medicine, government, social services, legal services, engineers, landlords, churches, to name a few institutions, are scrambling to adapt to the needs and the unique gifts of an aging population. I've learned in the short while that I've been a pastor here at First United Methodist that one size does not fit all when it comes to the needs and interests, activities and abilities, and spiritual lives of our senior members and their cohort. While seniors often benefit from experience and embrace and offer wisdom, they may also be as free as any of the rest of us to make bad choices and mistakes and unwise moves. Their age doesn't proof against that. We can't stereotype this group accurately as we cannot any other group and still see them with God's heart. Eric Erickson, perhaps the most famous developmental psychologist, places senior adulthood in the whole of a human lifespan. Each age group has its own developmental task. Babies need to attach, then learn independence and self-care tasks. Small children need to learn to form social bonds outside the family and to learn the body of knowledge that will prepare them for school. You know, you sang the ABC song. Erickson continues through the lifespan until we arrive at those whom we are celebrating today, and he calls this phase of life maturity. Erickson says, older adults need to look back on life and feel a sense of fulfillment. Success for senior adults leads to feelings of wisdom. He describes this developmental task as integrity versus despair. And I certainly hope you are here with mostly the former, not the latter, not despair. But having said that, no one gets through life without some challenges. When we make assumptions about someone by looking at physical appearance and characteristics, we miss the mark. While I would maintain that most of those over the age of 75 have given some thought to the ultimate disposition of their lives, souls, and bodies, we cannot assume anything beyond that. There's no universal sentiment, and it's not the case that all senior adults have found faith and are settled in for the ride. So hear me now. One of our primary opportunities for making disciples and teaching them about their faith is with the senior adult population. They may not have given faith much thought at earlier points in their lives, but I would maintain that it is a rare soul who is not giving some thought to his or her eternal disposition at the aged point in life. Amazing what modern science can do. We've come a long way since Benjamin Braddock heard the advice, I just want to say one word to you. Just one word. Plastics. Now chemicals have invented something called self-healing polymers. Who hasn't had your car scratched by another car's door or by a shopping cart in a parking lot? Now, You can just park your car in the sun, and within a few hours, the scratch is gone. Let's see a quick video of how this works.
Discover what's possible when we think research at Case Western Reserve University.
You find a nasty scratch on your new car. Now what? This research team at the Case School of Engineering may have just found the key.
We came up with this idea to basically develop a coating that if it was scratched, you could simply take out a light and heal the scratch.
Stuart Rowan's engineering team had already developed a material for a separate use, but surprisingly had all the necessary components for this endeavor.
Just as a quick experiment, we took out a razor blade and deliberately scratched the material and then put it under a UV light. And within 30 seconds, the scratch had disappeared. That was the eureka moment. That was like, wow, we've got something that's really cool here.
So what's the scientific secret?
So what we've developed is essentially a new plastic material composed of very small chains that stick together and assemble into much larger chains. But what we've designed into the molecule is essentially the ability for it to disassemble on exposure to light. When it disassembles, the material flows into the crack and the system gets healed.
And the discovery is just scratching the surface of possibilities.
What you can imagine is essentially a new paint coating on your car that you can heal whenever someone's rubbed a key down the side of it. Another one is this could be a new varnish for your dining room table, where you get a scratch on your table that can be easily removed.
The next step is to use the proven concepts to design a commercial coating tailored for specific uses.
Because it has such interesting applications, we've had discussions with a number of companies on how we might be able to translate this out to the public.
Learn more on how Case Western Reserve University thinks beyond the possible at case.edu.
Self-healing. What a great metaphor that is. Our souls have been made for all eternity of self-healing materials. While some nonagenarians exercise every day and work full-time, the truth is that these mortal bodies of ours break down. They wear out. Illness gets to the best of us. But these bodies are not our ultimate endpoint. We go the way of all the earth, as the scripture said. Consider what you really believe about immortality. Is it what you believed 10 years ago, or when you were 10 years old? And for some of you, think back 40 or 70 or 80 years. You see, for this perishable body must put on imperishability, and this mortal body must put on immortality. Our souls are made of self-healing materials. Along with the task of integrity versus despair, finding wisdom, we must settle our score with mortality. And most of us don't like it one bit, but our bodies fail us. Only God never fails us. And not only that, but God doesn't fail to provide us with self-healing, with God-healing. God has a purpose for every one of us. Throughout the time we are on this earth in this form, it is not only children who are invited to come to Christ. It is adults who are invited, teens, young adults, junior adults, elderly folks. All are welcome at the feast, and we will feast with Christ in a heavenly banquet. Don't write off senior adults. God isn't finished with them yet, and God isn't finished with you. Yet, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not evil, to give you a future and a hope, from Jeremiah 29:11. We need to get busy living, living out the plans God has for each of us in this crazy circle that is life. Amen.
Thank you so much, Pastor Jeannie. We're so grateful for Pastor Jeannie and her ministry among our senior adults and among us all. God's call is to find a way to work throughout our lives for our souls to mature and to grow every day. And one way that we believe we do that here at First United Methodist Church is to find ways to become a blessing, ways that we can bless the lives of others with how God has put us together uniquely. As we prepare for offering, there are two ways I want to highlight about how we grow, how we mature by becoming a blessing for others. The first is, yesterday we had our Fuse Day. Pastor Jeannie mentioned that up here on the screen. If you can see really, really small pictures, you can see many people who were at Thorpe Gordon yesterday from our church wearing the bright orange t-shirts and a few others as well. And all sorts of wonderful things happened at Thorpe Gordon yesterday in our work day there. We painted dots where the kids could stand in line. We redid basketball goals and soccer goals and painted water fountains and planted trees and all sorts of stuff. So we give thanks to God for the ways that so many of you made a difference at Thorpe Gordon yesterday. The other way I want to highlight that we continue to become a blessing, that we're invited to invest ourselves in the difference God is making in the lives of people right here in Jefferson City, is to invite us to prepare next week for our Stewardship Sunday. This week you're going to be getting a card, a pledge card in the mail and a letter about ways that we can give of ourselves, invest ourselves in the difference that God is making in our church. And one way we're thinking about that and praying about that in the weeks leading up to Stewardship Sunday next weekend is by hearing from different people in the congregation what First United Methodist Church means for them, what difference it has made in their lives. This morning, we're grateful to God for Clint and Christina Barnett, who are going to speak a moment about what First United Methodist means to them.
Good morning. I'm Christina. This is Clint. We have three children, not with us this morning, but we do have them. Grace is 14 in the 8th grade. Livy is 11 in the 6th grade. And Hayden is 6 in kindergarten. And when I start to think about the difference that God and this church has made in our lives, I start to think about how God has always been a part of our life. We both grew up attending church on a regular basis, but as we became adults and married and started having a family of our own, we started to feel pulled in a different direction than how we were raised. So we started to search and search and search some more. And finally, a few short years ago, we found ourselves here. And for me, it was a huge sigh of relief. The Barnetts had found a new church home. And, you know, from that point, in just a few short years, we've been blessed with being a part of a wonderful preschool program, children's ministries, and now our girls are older and they're part of a youth group that they love, and that's just to name a few. And so this morning I just want to say thank you to God for bringing us here, and thank you to you, First United Methodist Church, for taking us in. Thanks.
A year or so ago, I had an opportunity to fulfill kind of a childhood dream. We're a pretty outdoorsy family, if you will, enjoying all manner of outdoor activities. And some of us take that to a bit of an extreme. And last year, with the blessing and support of my awesome family, I thru-hiked the Appalachian Trail. It took 5 months. I walked a little over 2,200 miles through the Appalachian Mountains from Georgia to Maine. And as you might expect, several little stories kind of unfold along the way. I'd like to share one with you real quick this morning. You might remember that winter here came fairly late. I think it was middle of February maybe before we had any snow here. And then we had several big ones here. And the same thing happened out there. I would talk to Christina on the phone and she would tell me to get ready because in 2 or 3 days later it would hit out there. And on March 31st, this past year, I was on a mountain in northeast Tennessee. It was Roan Mountain in northeast Tennessee, and I was in a pretty bad place. It had been snowing off and on for 6 weeks. Temperatures were dipping down into single digits at night, and physically, I was healthy and strong. Mentally and emotionally, I was just a wreck. I was tired of walking through the snow and sleeping in the snow and just being cold all the time. On top of that, just a few days prior, Christina and the kids had come out and visited while the kids were on spring break. And then they dumped me off and I climbed back up into the snow with this fresh reminder in my head of how much I really enjoy being with my family and I could be doing that instead of, you know, walking through the snow, sleeping in the snow. Those factors kind of combine to form this kind of perfect storm of self-doubt. And I was just tired of being in my head and was just mentally and emotionally spent. And I'm on this mountain. It's Easter Sunday. And I'm collecting water from this little stream. And quite literally out of nowhere, this young couple comes walking down the mountain. And I distinctly remember being really surprised to see them because it's Easter Sunday. The mountain's covered in snow. Nobody in their right mind is out there. And there they are. So we have, you know, we have small talk. We talk a little bit and they ask me about my journey. And we are about to part ways. I'm going to head up and they're going to head down. And they stop, and the man asks if they could pray for me. So there's these two people that I've never met before. They take their gloves off, put their hands on me, and pray for my safe travels and my family's well-being back at home. So we part ways. They head down. I turn around and head up, and I make it maybe a couple yards before the emotional floodgates just burst open, and I'm just standing there in waist-deep snow, crying on the side of this mountain, just completely overloaded emotionally. And I pull myself together and go over that mountain and eventually a couple hundred more and make it all the way to Maine. But what happened that day to me was a very overt example of God kind of having my back. He didn't part the snow like the Red Sea. He sent me just enough of what I needed right then through prayers of a stranger, and it changed everything. And that is how God, I think, has a huge impact on us as a family. Just knowing that that presence is there and that he kind of has our back makes life's bumps in the occasional snowy mountain just so much easier. And we feel that here with you guys also. And we're eternally grateful for that. Thank you.
One of the saints of the church has called Holy Communion the medicine of immortality. So we come here today with these mortal bodies. We come here today with whatever it is that we carry. Maybe this morning didn't go so well for us, or maybe we're a little afraid, or maybe we've been given a diagnosis, or someone we love has died. And we don't have answers, and we don't know where to turn. And just in time, God's going to send somebody down the snowy mountain. And one way that God sends is to give us this gift of life. Jesus' very life poured out for us. Easter was coming. but that was going to be hard to see over the next couple of days. So Jesus shared a meal with his disciples, the highest holy day of the year for them. And when they'd been enjoying supper for a while, they had lamb, they had fresh greenery, they had a bitter herb to remember the taste of slavery on their mouth. And Jesus continued through the liturgy, which was called the Haggadah. And he took bread and broke pieces of it off and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you." What they did not expect him to say. And likewise, when supper was over, he took the cup, and it was their fourth cup of wine for the night. He blessed it. "Blessed are you, Lord God of the universe, who gives us the fruit of the vine." And he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you shall in memory of me." So we may not have been sitting there literally that night when he shared the bread and the cup, but it extends to us. Christians in all times and all places since that night have shared this. And every time we do, we remember. We remember God's love for us. We remember Jesus' life poured out for us. We remember that Easter Sunday is coming. In the United Methodist Church, we have what's called an open communion. That means all who feel invited by Christ are welcome at the feast. Likewise, if you choose not to partake, please understand that God is with you and touches you in quite a different way. If you'd like to, you can take communion by intinction. That is, take a piece of the bread, dip it in the cup. Take both elements at one time, but also, if you need gluten-free elements or would like an individual cup, they're available on the side tables. We'll be taking our offering at the same time as you're coming forward for communion. Just a reminder that we remind ourselves we're not paying for the communion, but we joyfully come forward and give and receive at once. And I want you to know that all things are ready and the gifts of God are for you, for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Would those who are assisting in communion please come?
Meal is ready. Invitation has been offered. As the Spirit leads you, will you come to the Lord's feast? Thank you. Let us pray. Oh God, we are yours and you are ours, and we are so thankful. We are grateful that you never leave us or forsake us, and that you find us in every stage of life, on sides of mountains, and right here. Receive this offering as a sign of our gratitude. Bless and use it for the work of Jesus Christ. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Hope you'll be back next week. We are done talking about the individual agents of the circle of life, but we can have one more week in our circle of life series where we talk about ways that we can support and invest ourselves in all of this blessing. It is our Stewardship Sunday next week. You'll be receiving a letter and card. You know, in a strange, weird way, Stewardship Sunday has gotten to be one of my favorite Sundays of the year. I never thought I would have said that a few years ago, but it is because of what God is doing. It's a great celebration. Hope you can be back next week for a special and holy weekend in the life of the church. For now, stand on up, please, as we get ready to leave this place. Let us go forth in peace this week to serve God, to serve the neighbors that God has given us. Let us go forth to grow in Christ, to mature in Christ, and know that God goes with you this day and always. Amen.